Good morning. How's everybody doing this morning? We got a lot of new faces here. There must be something going on with babies or something. Once y'all stand up, I'm sure you've already greeted one another. Let's just begin to welcome King Jesus in the place. Just begin to thank him for being with us, being around us, being in us. Lord, we bless your name this morning. We welcome you in this place. We welcome you. Come have your way today, Lord. Have your way. There's none like you. There's none like you. And we just bless your name. And we give you all the glory and all the praise. And may you be exalted in our nation, O God. We welcome you this morning. The doors, the King of Glory's coming. Through city streets and living hearts, we see His Spirit moving. Now His kingdom comes. Now His will be done.
Lift up your banners and practice your praise. Fill up your mouths with the glory.
Shout all you people and dance through the time. same old road for miles and miles. If you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies. If you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, well, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you've been walking, if you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles. If you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies. If you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, well, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker.
We've all searched
for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. And there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, we're saving. He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker.
Talks about breaking chains and those things that have attached themselves to us in the spiritual, in the natural, but he's also talking about real life things. And the Lord just reminded me, my brother, my younger brother, I love him so much, but he made some bad choices and he ended up in prison. And the Lord kept telling me he's going to be okay, but he also had cancer. He had cancer twice. And when he was in prison, he ended up in hospice. And they would not release him. They wouldn't even send him home to die. They just kept him. And the Lord told me, I'm going to bring him home, and he's going to be okay. And he opened those gates, and he brought my brother home. My brother is alive and well today. He breaks those chains. Those who are physically in prison, I'm speaking to you. If you're watching today, if you've been in prison, if you're in prison, the Lord is a mighty God, and He will break those chains. He will open those gates, and you will be free in Jesus' name.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when
never stop working. Never stop, never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, never stop working. Never stop,
sing it out.
Never
He's working all things out.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, you never stop working. Never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, you never stop working. Never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness.
Father, we are so grateful, oh God, this day that you're alive, that you're not a God that's distant, that you're not a God that doesn't listen, doesn't hear, doesn't speak, but you are a God of relationships. You are our Father, Abba, Daddy God, the God who's always good all the time. Father, we thank you, Lord, your hands upon our nation, that you, God, are breathing life upon this country. Let us, oh God, truly be a United States of America and a people, God, that come together, especially in the church of Jesus Christ. Unite our hearts, unite, oh God, our spirits. Let us, oh God, have a one voice, and that is, oh God, to reap the harvest, to glorify the name of Jesus Christ, and to see you, God, have your way upon this earth as your way, oh God, your will is done in heaven. We give praise and thanks. This time we bless our babies. We bless, oh God, our adults. We thank you, Lord, for families and all those that are here, God. We just thank you, Lord, you touch their hearts right where they're at. And bring us, oh God, a spiritual deposit that shall remain. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We can have those lights up full blast. That'll help us out a lot, too, at the front. You all can have a seat. We're going to take the first part of this service after worship and praise. It's a great time there just to glorify God, lift up His name. We want to welcome all the people that have come that are extended family members of all the babies that are here today. We haven't had this baby dedication now for several months, of course, so there's a whole lot of babies just to be praying over and just blessing them for God's sake and their lives as well. But we appreciate you parents and all the grandparents and in-laws, all the folks that have come out here today to be a part of this with us as well. It's going to be a meaningful time. We're going to take it, and when it comes time to actually pray over the babies, we'll call up each family one at a time and have you guys kind of stand over here where there's more space. And then if you don't want us to take and touch your child, let us know about that as well. Otherwise, I'll be just taking and just at least touching the child. There'll be at least one baby I'll probably hold. Amen. One baby. I know I can hold that baby, and she's fine. I'm fine with that as well and the family. But I'll be glad just to touch your child. But if you don't want just kind of be at a distance, we'll be aware of that as well and make sure we do that with your baby. Let's read now Mark chapter 10, starting in verse 13. This actually is a tremendous passage of scripture here, because we got to realize again, the Bible may seem big and long to us, but it's actually very short compared to how long this world's been around and how many words could have been spoken. So God, by His Spirit, was very concise when He wrote down the words in the Bible. And the Bible says every verse was given by the inspiration, the breath of Almighty God. How many folks know that it's breath being attacked right now this year? This is the prophetic year of the mouth. And we see the breath being attacked by the choking of the neck of the person up there and up north by the police. We see the choking of also this coronavirus. We see the choking off of the mask being worn to restrict our breathing as well. And so we got to know the enemy himself is at warfare against breath. And so we are praying in the prayer room this morning that God's breath gets released once again upon this earth, upon this nation here. And that that breath of God will blow out the breath of hell and remove that breath of hell in Jesus' name. And all the things that constrict and all the things that hold us back will be removed with God's grace. So saying all that, in Mark chapter 10, Jesus Christ is actually blessing babies and children. Now, this would not be in the Bible unless it's actually important and something was actually happening significant when he was actually doing this. And so it says, they brought young children, even babies, to Jesus that he might touch them. But the disciples rebuked those who brought them. But when Jesus saw this, he was greatly displeased. And he said to them, let the little children come to me. Do not forbid them, for such is the kingdom of God. And he took them up in his arms, put his hands on them, and he blessed them. And that word bless there talks about imparting with eternal, with life, with the goodness of God, the plan of God, the will of God. Everything that God's goodness represents is in that word blessed. How many folks want your children blessed? I know all of us do. All of us love our children. We want to see the best for them. And all of us also know our children will only know the best in life if Jesus Christ is the center of their lives and God rules and reigns in their lives. Amen? So saying all that, we have the first family come to the front here. One guy's on the platform here, Greg and Michelle Barnes. We have Kristen coming up here, and Cheryl to help me out. Kristen's going to hand out certificates and little baby Bibles as well to all the babies, all the young children that are coming up here to get dedicated today. Good. All right, this is Greg and Michelle Barnes. Little girl's name is Allison Nicole DiCarlo. This is a Gaelic name. Allison is. This means truthful one. And the spiritual connotation of Allison is holy one. Her middle name, Nicole, is a Greek name that means victorious one. It also means overcomer. Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 27, for Allison says, and I will put my spirit within you, and I will cause you to walk on my statute and in my statutes. And you shall keep my judgments, and you shall do them, says the Lord. Let's just take this, reach our hands, our faith out right now towards Allison, toward this couple as well, that are raising this grandchild of theirs. And we're just going to ask God's blessing to be upon them and upon Allison also. Father, we thank and praise you for Allison's precious life. We ask you, Lord God, to use her for your glory, that your goodness and mercy, God, be manifest in her and through her all the days of her life. We pray, God, that you make the plan you have for her come unfolded, God, before her. Let your yoke be easy, your burden be light. We speak protection, God, upon her from the powers of darkness. And we say the will of God be accomplished in her and through her, God, all the days of her life. Help her, God, make right friendships, right relationships, oh God, the right education, the right schools to go to. Give her, God, a path to walk in that's full of light. May all darkness and all confusion, God, be broken before her. We bless, oh God, Greg and Michelle. We thank you, Lord, for their lives, as mother as well, for this child. That you bless him, God, with love, divine love. Let them, God, see things that they would not see in the natural realm. They'll see things by the supernatural for Allison. What to pray for, what to pray about. Things of God to instruct her in. Give them wisdom, God, in this. And we praise you, Lord, for friends and loved ones around them as well. The counsel of God to be their portion for this precious little girl. And we bless her, God, and thank you, God. We dedicate her life to you now, Father. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen. God bless you, folks. God bless you. All right. The next family is the Beber family. This is James and Zulema. And you can bring up all the family members you want to bring up here as well. There's room up here. This is Derek Sebastian Beber. And then also we have, on my next page here, Elena Zoe Beber. We got the brother and sister here. This is a precious little boy and girl. I'm going to go ahead and read about Derek first of all. Derek is a Teutonic name that means ruler, and it means in divine order. The name Sebastian is a Greek name that means honorable, and it means esteemed one. And Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 26 says, God gives to a man what is good in his sight, wisdom and knowledge and joy. Let's read also about Elena. Elena Zoe Beber. Her name is a Greek name that means bright, beautiful. The spiritual connotation of this name is universal harmony. The name Zoe is a Greek name that means life and dwelling in the spirit. John chapter 13, verse 35 says, "By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love one to another." So let's go ahead and reach our hands out, our faith once again here for Derek and for Elena. Let's bless this couple as well. We give praise and thanks, oh God, now for these precious babies, these young children, God. We thank you, Lord, your hands upon them for grace, for goodness, and mercy, and love. We dedicate, oh God, their lives to you, Father, and say, may all their days be drenched with the dew of heaven. May God, your joy overtake them, Father. May laughter be in their house. May peace, oh God, rule and reign in their hearts. May you cut off every work of the enemy, God, that tries to snare them in any way in the future. We just declare also together right now for divine friendships. They'll know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior at a young age, even being filled with the Holy Spirit. We praise you, God, the plan you have for their life unfolds for them, God, easily. And we thank you, Lord, those parents, God, are blessed. They see things again themselves, also by the Spirit, for their children. They know what to pray, when to pray. They know what is wrong associations. They see those traps and snares of the enemy, and they help to see them cut off. And they also see open doors, open heavens, God, given to this precious boy, this precious girl. And Father, we also thank you, O God, for people who come around them, their friends, loved ones, family members. They shall be, O God, a support. They shall be a blessing. And they shall only do good for them, Father, all the days of their life. We dedicate, O God, this young man, this young lady, God, in Jesus' precious name to you, Father. And we thank you for them. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Yes. These cute outfits. All right, our next family here is the Garcias, Michael, Daniel, and Esmeralda Garcia. Are you folks, are they? They're over here. Let's go ahead and come right up here. They're going to bring Miguel, Angel, Daniel, and also Daisy, Angel Garcia. All right, good to see you guys. Now, this one here is Miguel. Let's reach our hands, our faith out right now towards Miguel, and also here towards Daisy. And that's God's blessing and grace to be upon them. The name Miguel is a name, of course, it's Michael in English. A very godly name. Spanish-American name. That means champion, victorious spirit. An angel means a Latin name that means messenger. It means bringer of glad tidings. Philippians chapter 2, verse 13 says, "For it is God which works in us both to do and will according to his good pleasure." And I really believe that God's going to take and have his way in Miguel's life. According to his pleasure, God's pleasure in his life. For Daisy, her name is an Anglo-Saxon name that means quickened spirit. The spiritual connotation for your name also is one that means messenger, bringer of glad tidings. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4 says, "According as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy without blame before him in love." Let's reach our hands out right now towards Miguel, towards Daisy. Let's just speak blessings right now upon them together as a congregation that God has his way in their lives. Father, we thank you for precious Miguel. We thank you, Lord, for the hand of God upon him, that you'd use him for your glory in the days ahead. We praise you, God, that his path also is drenched with the dew of heaven. There comes, oh God, to him open heavens, open doors for evangelism, for winning folks to Christ, for doing the work of your kingdom. Help him, God, to have a mind that is very, very sharp and very acute, God, to be learning the things he needs to learn for the future. We say, God, you open up to him doors of education, God, doors of provision, and doors, oh God, to reach others for your kingdom. We see him as a blessing, God, for friends around him. He shall be a mouthpiece. May his mouth, oh God, be opened wide with the love of Jesus Christ and speak the very words of God for people around him as you make him, God, a prayer warrior and one, oh God, who battles the powers of darkness successfully, Father, in the days ahead, in Jesus' name. We praise you, God, and thank you for Daisy. Hand of God upon her. Thank you, Lord, that you're touching her body, her soul, her spirit, God, in all ways, giving her, God, completeness and wholeness, and giving her, God, also joy and laughter. We praise you, God, that as she is being led through life, oh God, by your spirit, she has right associations, right friendships, oh God, people, oh God, that would gather around her and be a blessing to her. Cut off every work of the enemy that tries to bring pain, that tries to bring confusion, or that tries to take her down to a wrong path. And we declare her body is whole, it is healed, it is right. And she will live out all the days ordained for her upon this earth, Father, in Jesus' name. Father, we dedicate right now this precious boy and this girl, oh God, to your kingdom, to your work, and your glory. Thank you, God, for this father, this mother. Bless them, God, with your grace, with your wisdom, with your anointing and your skills. Show them, God, things in the spiritual realm they need to see for their children in the days ahead. Help them, God, know what to pray, when to pray, and help them, God, also to know what is right in associations, God, for these precious children's lives. We give praise and thanks, oh God, for all these things. In Jesus' name, dedicating them, oh God, to you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Let's give them a hand as well. God bless little Miguel, Daisy. We're going to be calling up the Epps now. It's our youth pastors. Trey and Shay Epps have a little one-year-old baby, one-year-old, only a couple of days ago. Alina Lynn Epps is her name as well. These folks, God sent them here from Mississippi, and they've enjoyed Texas thus far. We'll see if Alina has a smile for us today. You're doing good. Good to see you again. Love her little dress. So I was looking up Alina's name here. Alina was one that took some more research, but it's a Gaelic name that means noble, that means honorable. Her middle name, Lynn, is a Gaelic name also that means clear pool and generous spirit. The Bible says in John chapter 11, verse 22, but I know, even now, whatsoever you will ask of God, God will give it to you. So somehow, some way, this girl's been given a name of generosity, of increase, of blessings is going to flow in her and through her to others as well. So let's reach our hands, our faith out now towards the Epps, these parents, this precious girl as well. And Father, we give you praise and thanks for little Alina. Thank you, Lord God, for his smooth and safe delivery. Thank you, God, for protection, God, upon her heart and life throughout all the days of her life. We praise you, God, that she also has right associations in the days ahead. Help her, God, make good decisions, godly decisions. Close to her, God, the desires of hell, that they will not prevail over her, Father, in any way. But only the desires of your kingdom, God, be upon her. Lord, her angels with her every day. May the angel of God go before her, protect her, God, bless her with also the dew of heaven. Bless, oh God, this father, this mother. Use them, God, for your glory. Give them wisdom, guidance, and direction, Father, in schooling, in friendships, in the teenage years ahead. We praise you, God, you go before them. Give them patience. We thank you, Lord, for discernment. And Father, we just say, oh God, this little baby girl belongs to Jesus, belongs to God. And these are only parents that are stewards of her. Let them, God, just be blessed all the days of their life as they raise her up and see her grow in the things of God. In Jesus' name, we dedicate her to you now, Father. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Here's your little book and bye. Now we have the Hatleys coming up here. The Hatleys have twins. And they're just right in this area. These little twins are special as well because they were born with a mother who was very strong, very courageous, and God was with her every part of that pregnancy. And many folks say, we're glad it was you. These babies' names also, we took some research here. Luke helped me out a little bit. Their names are, let me look at this here. Make sure I get this pronounced right. Soraya Rose Hatley and Adeline Sela Hatley. Adelaide. Okay, so Adelaide is which one? One in the little gray. All right, so, well, darker shade of gray. Okay. Let's go ahead and reach our hands, our faith out toward his precious little twin girls. Ask God's blessings upon their lives. Father, we thank you, Lord, so much and praise you for Adelaide, for Soraya. Lord God, that your hands upon them. That your blessings overtake them, oh God. Lord, as I'm reading this, I see that Soraya's name is the Hebrew name that means rare and means also a sun princess. So, Father God, we just see that brilliance just shining through Soraya. We see, oh God, the light of your glory, God, overtaking her in the days ahead. Her middle name is a Greek name that means symbol of love, God's gracious gift. And Isaiah 62:3 says over her that you shall also be a crown of glory in the hand of the Lord, and you shall also be a royal diadem in the hand of your God. Adelaide, your name is a name that is a Hebrew name that actually means, or it means witness and living God's word. Your middle name, Sela, is a Hebrew word that means rock. 1 Corinthians 13:58, let's speak this over her right now. 1 Corinthians 15:58, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord, it is blessed of God. Father, we speak blessings, God, upon these precious girls, that you'd use them, God, for your glory in the days ahead. May they come to Christ as Lord and Savior at a young age. May they understand, oh God, the things of the Spirit. May they have, oh God, a propensity for praise, for worship, for spiritual warfare, God, for intercessory prayer, and to do the work of the kingdom. Bless, oh God, this father, this mother, that they, oh God, would see the children, God, the way you see them prophetically. They would speak life over them. They speak your word over them. And, oh God, all their needs be met. And, oh God, we see them as a people of peace, people of joy, and a house full of laughter, and a house full, God, of an incubator that's going to send them out in the world as ambassadors for Jesus Christ. We dedicate these young girls, God, to you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Praise God. God bless you. Next family is the Regatius family. These are right here in this middle area. I think the little girl's name is Ruth Ann. Nicole Regatius. Did Dr. Crosco show up today? Did not make it. He's a very busy guy. This is a doctor that helped save our daughter's life years ago in her rare disease. And doctors were saying that this would never happen. This little girl would not be born because of all that this woman went through years ago with a rare disease that God did miracles in her body with. And God told her on almost her deathbed, you will have a child. And your grandparents, your parents will see that child. And so this is a living miracle here, how God worked in behalf of this couple and brought them together. Ruth Ann's name is a name that is Hebrew, that means compassionate and beautiful. And the spiritual connotation for Ruth Ann is pure one. Nicole is a Greek name that means victorious one, overcomer. And Psalms 119, verse 73 says, your hands have made me and fashioned me. Give me understanding that I may learn your commandments. Let's just hold this. See if I can, hold her and let her not, not cry. Hey, baby, can Papa hold you? There you go. That's a good baby. All right. We're going to pray over you. Now, Father, we thank you, Lord, for Ruth Ann. Thank you for the grace of God upon her life, for bringing her here, Father, in wholeness and love. Bless her, God, with the dew of heaven. Give her guidance and direction for the future. Help her know you as the Lord and Savior at a young age. And we praise you, God, she'd be filled with the Spirit also, at even an early age as well. We praise you, God, that you give her the plan that you have for her life through her parents and through circumstances. That you, God, guide her in education, guide her in friendships. Bring divine protection, God, upon her life. That no fiery dart of Satan can penetrate the shield of faith around her, but, oh God, that your will be accomplished in her and through her. Help her, God, have joy and peace and laughter, and help her reach out to other people, God, in days ahead, and share the love of Jesus Christ. Let her name, God, Ruth Ann, be one who is close to the Holy Spirit and follows you, God, every day of her life. We bless, oh God, this father and mother. We thank you, Lord, for Nate, for Sarah, God. You bless them with wisdom and guidance for Ruth Ann's life. Give them, oh God, provision. Give them guidance. Give them direction, Father. Let them see things they need to see for the days ahead. Know what to pray and when to pray. And we thank you, oh God, that you also help to cut off the desires of hell. And you help to loose, oh God, the desires of heaven for this baby's life. We give praise and thanks and dedicate her to you, God, this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Your mama. All right, we have now Eloy and Lexi Rodriguez. If you come up here, we have a little Elia. And this is also Esther, precious grandmother. Elia's name is a name that actually means, it's an Arabic name that means highness and exalted. The spiritual connotation for this name, Elena, is a gift from God. This is a little gift from God from the very birth. The middle name here, Rain, Elia Rain Rodriguez, is an English name that means rule and sovereign. And Psalm 16, verse 11 says, You shall show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. And at your right hand there are pleasures forevermore. So God's going to take in somehow, some way, I believe prophetically, take Aliyah and give her just supernatural exaltations, promotions, recognitions. And it's going to take her and just do things to help her also be a leader, because her name talks about ruling, reigning, and being an exalted one with the exalted one as well. Let's reach our hands and our faith out right now toward these parents, towards Aliyah as well. And that's God's blessing upon her. Father, we give you praise and thanks, O God, that you have put this child here for such a time as this. We declare, God, the plan that you have for her life is going to be yes and amen. That you, O God, just annihilate the desires of hell. That you bring forth, God, the desires of your kingdom for her. We speak right now, divine protection, divine wisdom, divine favor, God, be your portion. And we thank you, Lord, for friendships that are godly, that are righteous, that are of you. We praise you, God, you cut off what is ungodly, unwholesome, and of the enemy. Bless, O God, this father, this mother. Give them, O God, wisdom and grace to raise this child up in the fear and the admonition of God. Help them, Lord, to find disciplines in their own lives on a weekly basis, God, and just talk to them about the love of Jesus Christ and share with her testimonies and the songs of God. And may praise, O God, fill her ears and fill her home and fill her life. We say, O God, that she belongs to you. These are only stewards, God, of this precious gift. And so we say, O Lord, just give them, O God, your desires for her. Make them known, O God. We dedicate this child to you, Father, in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. Praise God. God bless you, folks. We have one more baby. This is Ava Weaver, Christine and James Weaver, with a baby named Ava Weaver. Are they here today? Let's go ahead and come to the front. Christine and James Weaver. This has been a miracle. Every single person that signed up is here. So you can go ahead and stand up for her if you don't mind. Christine and James Weaver. Ava Marie Weaver. Grandma's here. Brother's here. Hope we're going to get some good pictures after church here, especially. You're almost out doing your sister there. Ava is a name that's a Latin name that means filled with grace. The spiritual connotation for Ava is one whose heart is filled with song. The name Marie is a Hebrew name that means awareness, spiritual awareness. It also means blessed one. Psalms 106, verse 11 says, "Praise ye the Lord, O give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good and his mercy endures forevermore." We give praise and thanks. Now, this baby Ava, we just are seeing her right now, even as a child, is going to be singing. There's going to be praise and worship going out of her and going through her. Let's just reach our hands, our faith out now towards this family, this precious girl as well. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for the health this child has. We praise you, God, that she is strong, not just in body, but strong in soul and strong in spirit. Now, Lord, we just see, God, the praise of God coming out of her mouth. We see worship, God, just defining her in the days ahead. And so, Lord, we just say anything the enemy tries to do to annihilate the plan you have for her life is not going to happen. But, oh, God, your plans are yes and amen for her. We speak protection, God, upon her. We speak longevity of life. We speak blessings of provision, of education, of godly friends and loved ones around her. And, Father, we bless this father, this mother. We thank you, God, for them. We say, use them, God, for your glory to raise up this child and also even this little boy as well. Help them, God, to have a harmonious home, a home full of laughter and joy and peace, and a home where Jesus Christ is center of all that is said and done. We give praise and thanks, O God, as we dedicate this little baby into your name and your hand. We praise you and thank you for it, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You guys. All right. Well, if you have a desire to get babies dedicated in the future, let us know. We're never done, never totally finished. Amen. We'll keep right on doing that as well. We're going to take and spend time now serving communion. So we have all of our volunteers that are here. Go ahead and come to the front. And as far as our communion service goes, we do this the first Sunday of each month. If you are a born-again believer in Jesus Christ, you can feel comfortable to join us with this today. Because of the restrictions here about social distancing and so forth, about germs, we have all these little cup sealed, where actually, if you take the cup out, there'll be the little wafer in the bottom that you eat, and then the juice on the top. And you can take it, hold that in your hand here in a moment. We'll have you guys go ahead and just come to the front here, just left side, go ahead and start coming to the front, just walk up here. Let's all stand up. Let's all take a stand. We can make it easier. You folks to the far right over here, my far right, just go ahead and start walking to the front here. You can take these cups, take them back to your seats. We're going to take communion together in a moment. We can do that, okay? So just go ahead and make your way to your seats, front row, middle rows can split up if you want to, either way, left or right, in the middle section here. Start coming to the front here and take your little cup there as well. What's it? Oh, that's right. Yeah, you that are online out there, go ahead and grab some grape juice, something that's liquid there, of course, a cracker. You can join us as well. I'm going to be reading here from 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12. As these folks are walking to the front and taking these cups, taking them back to their seat as well. The Bible, it tells us that as often as we do this communion, we do it in remembrance of who Jesus Christ himself actually is. What that means is something took place that was very, very powerful and significant when Jesus Christ shed his blood and let his body be broken for you and I. If you look at, do a study sometime about all the things that happened to Jesus Christ on the cross, even before the cross, you're going to find prophetically every disease, every sickness, every curse, every iniquity, every sin was atoned for by the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. But only one thing's missing. And that one thing missing is God gave all of us a free will to accept that sacrifice or reject that sacrifice. God wanted to give his best gift to you and I to show us how much he loved us. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. Whosoever believes in him will not perish, but will come into eternal life in the days ahead. Communion is not a thing that saves us. We understand that. But it reminds us of the promises we have through the working of Jesus Christ over 2,000 years ago. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12 and 13 says, "Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trials which will try you as though some strange thing happened to you. But rejoice in the extent that you partake in Christ's sufferings, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy yourself." Now this talks about, you know, the bread, the body, the blood, all talks about suffering. Jesus Christ, the Bible says, willfully laid his body, his life down, willfully, so that we might not have the same suffering he had himself. And I know that God still heals, God still delivers, God still transforms, God still brings forth salvation, but we must be those who receive that by faith and accept that also by faith. And so I encourage you guys again that are out there online, that either are here live in the service today, never take for granted what Jesus Christ did for us. And never try to substitute this blood and this body by good works, by your grandparents' faith, by church attendance, by giving money. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 13, "Though I take and do all these loving things of works upon the earth, but I have not love, I'm a clanging cymbal, it's all meaningless." You must be born again. You must be saved. Amen. And so this reminds us today that this blood and this body was a costly price to pay for our sins and our healing. But praise God, it was paid for you and I. And so God is saying, now freely you have received, now freely give. What you receive yourself, give out to others. Let's take this bottom part, this bread in our fingers, and let's hold this up to God if we could. And I just dropped mine. Oh, here it went. This little wafer here represents God's body through Jesus Christ himself. And I'm so thankful and so grateful that every single disease and sickness and curse that can be named was paid for by the stripes on his back, by the thorns in his head, by the nails in his feet and his arms, his feet and his legs, and the spear in his side. All these represent curses being broken, healing being paid for, and good things coming to us today. Let's take this together, giving thanks to Jesus. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this cup in our hand. This juice represents the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us, God, know there's now, therefore, no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. But, oh God, no matter what we've done in life, even yesterday or last week or a year ago, it is all under the blood of Jesus Christ. And though our sins, your word says, becomes or looks like scarlet, they can be washed as white as snow and taken from us because of the shed blood of Jesus Christ. This blood, God, represents adoption and a covenant that can't be broken. Father, we give you thanks and praise. There's power over the works of darkness by the blood of Jesus Christ. This cup, of God, we have right now, let's take it together, giving thanks for Jesus Christ's blood that was shed for us. I praise God. Do we take these cups and just kind of leave them in our seats? Just put them on the floor, if you don't mind. Just on the floor there. We'll have people gather these later on in the service. So stand to our feet one more time. We're going to sing one more song of praise and worship. We're going to dismiss our children right now to go upstairs to Treehouse Kids. And let's give praise and thanks to him now together from our hearts for the goodness of our God.
Father, you've done great and mighty things for us, Lord. Maybe seated. Father, we thank you that you are faithful towards us. That, Lord, as we celebrate today, that you have done great and mighty things, you have on our behalf. And Father, you continue to do them. Because, Father, your word says that you are for us and not against us. That you go before us and that you make crooked paths straight. That you are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end of everything, Father, in our lives and those things around about us. And we thank you for that today, Father. Father, we thank you for each and every child that came forth this morning. Father, we don't take it lightly when we commit our children to you. We trust you with them, Father, and we thank you that your hand is upon each and every one of them and upon each and every family, because you are faithful to your people and your promises are yes and amen. And so we thank you for that today, Father, and we thank you that you're a God that is one that goes before us and makes crooked paths straight. And Lord, that you are the one that redeems us and that you are redemptive in our lives, Father. And we thank you for that today, God. We love you and we give you all the praise and all the glory today. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. God's good, isn't he? He's a good God. And you know, it's when we do things and like dedicate babies and pray over people, you know, I really believe that God moves heaven and earth and he takes note of things. Amen. He takes note of things. And when we dedicate people to the Lord, children, whatever, that is something that God takes note of. Amen. Because he hears our prayers and he is faithful towards us. And in Philippians 4 this morning, it says in verse 6, it says, do not fret or have an anxiety about anything, but in every circumstance and in everything by prayer and petition, definite requests with thanksgiving, continue to make your wants known to God, and God's peace, which transcends all understanding, shall garrison and mount guard over your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And I just want to encourage you this morning that, you know, during this time in life, as we walk through every day with things going on round about us, that, you know, sometimes we get a little fearful or unsteady. Amen. Am I the only one that ever gets unsteady? No, I'm sure you do. And there's times that we have to remind ourselves that we do not need to be fretting or anxious. Even if you feel like you may be retreating some or things may not be what they are, we can reset. We can reset where we're at when we go before the Lord and we spend time with him. It says, and peace will pass you and cover you, and you will be guarded over your heart with the peace and the understanding of the Lord. And so I want to encourage you today, if there's things going on in your life that are maybe being a little anxious or fearful or stuff going on that are not the way you thought it should be or the way it is, remember that God is the one that gives you peace that passes all understanding. I know it sounds like a little cliche, but he promises that in his word. Give thanks, give thanks. Sometimes we have to give thanks in faith and know that God does not stop and that we can continue and not give up. Amen? Because his word is true to us. And so I just want to encourage you to dig into the word of God. If you need some peace and you need some anxieties covered with the precious blood, pray and give thanks and trust him to finish what he's promised you in your life. Amen? He's not put on hold. He's not got a mask on and being muffled. Amen. He has all the freedom to do what he needs to do in your life. And he is not muzzled. Amen. And what you believe for and what you're trusting God for, when it comes to fear and anxiety, lay it at the feet of him. And he will speak to you. He will show you. Who believes God still speaks to us? If I didn't, I wouldn't be standing here. Amen. I know he speaks to me. He speaks to me. And his mercies are new every morning. Amen. And so I just give him praise and worship for his promises in this word to me and that he is faithful towards them. But I'm glad you're here with us celebrating today. Wasn't it amazing seeing all these little kiddos up here? And I told my husband, I don't think we've dedicated babies for a year, so we have to catch up, right? But it was amazing seeing them, and I do have to just give God glory for life and promises and prophecies and words that are spoken over every one of us, and God is faithful towards them. It was a day in my life that I didn't think my daughter would live, let alone that I would see her child and have a grandbaby, and God was faithful to his promises and his words. Amen. And people sitting in this room can testify to that. Amen. Can testify to the goodness and the graciousness and the kindness of God towards his people. Well, I'm glad that you all with us here today. If you're a first-time guest, we just want to welcome you. Our service is a little different today, but hey, it's been good, and I'm glad you're here with us. If you're online for the first time and watching us, there's a little space on our webpage that says, let's get connected. Click on that, and we would love to connect with you. If you have been online with us, and if you're here in the service, there's a perforated piece of paper on your bulletin. Fill it out, and we would just love to send you a letter and thank you for coming and joining us here today. We have a night of worship this Wednesday night here at the church. We usually have Wednesday nights online, but our worship night we always do here. You're welcome to come join us in person if you're comfortable. If not, it's going to be live fed onto Facebook, so you can join us that way. But if you can come on out, come and join us. We always have a great night of worship together. And then our Wednesday night series will continue the following week. But this Wednesday is worship night. And then prayer meeting is this Thursday also at 6 o'clock here at the church. If you want to come pray with us, come join us. We would love to have you. And I do believe that the discipleship course is back on track for today. If you've been doing that online via Zoom, join up at 3, and they would love to have you join them. This morning, we're going to show a one-minute video clip this morning real quick, but I just want to chat about this real quick. This is our Christmas shoebox, and it's called Samaritan's Purse, and we are going to be challenged to do 100 of these this year. If there's not a time ever that we need to do this, it is now. Amen. And inside the shoebox is your actual information on how to do it and how to fill it. And we would really love you to be involved in this outreach. It's a great outreach for you and your family and your children to do together. And it goes all over the world, all over the world. And we're going to show a quick clip on that. And then we also are beginning to do Angel Tree. And I believe, I'm not sure if that starts today or next week, but Angel Tree is also another outreach that we do to children whose parents are incarcerated. And we provide gifts for them from their parents that have requested it. And you can pick up an angel and fill that box. And all the dates and information is in your bulletin. So please make sure you pick up a box this morning in either foyer. And you and your family bless a child somewhere around the world. And so have we got that video? Okay, we're going to show that quick video. And then Pastor's going to be up to share with you. Thank you.
Hey, Tree of Life family, it's almost Christmas time. We have some amazing Christmas outreaches that are beginning this month. This year, more than ever, there are families and children in need. We have an opportunity to share the love of Jesus, and it's so easy to participate. Operation Christmas Child is a ministry of Samaritan's Purse, and they collect shoebox gifts filled with fun toys, school supplies, and hygiene items, and deliver them to children in need around the world to demonstrate God's love. TOLC has a goal of filling 100 boxes this year. You can find a box in the lobby today. There are instructions in the boxes on how to fill them, and all boxes are due by November 22nd. For more information, please contact me, Miss Kristen. Angel Tree shares the love of Christ in a tangible way and strengthens family bonds, delivering personalized gifts and the gospel to children on behalf of their incarcerated parents at Christmas. Every Angel Tree family is also given access to a free, easy-to-read copy of the Bible in English or Spanish. You can select an angel from our lobby starting November 16th. All gifts are due on or before December 6th. For more detailed information, contact Rochelle or Leslie, who will be available on our Angel Tree display. Joy is something that we all could use a little more of. And what better way to give and receive joy than to help a child out this Christmas? Merry Christmas, and let's get giving, TOLC.
Good. Those are two great outreaches, like Cheryl was saying as well. So just take advantage of those if you would before you leave this place today. I want to welcome the Vergacious family here. They've come all the way from Houston. We have them here, JR and Deanne as well. And then also the daughters come along, Mel with a brand new husband named Nick. And so we'll be having some grandbabies in the future here as well, other grandbabies. And for more little miracles here as well. Amen. All right. Well, I have a little bit of time here. So get your Bibles and let's look in the book of Matthew 16. As you turn there, there's some important birthdays happening. A couple of them this week. The son here, his name is Daniel. He's having a birthday this week. As I was praying about Daniel here, I received 1 Peter chapter 5 verse 10. May the God of grace perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. And so there's going to be some settling taking place, I believe, in his life this year for a birthday gift to him. And there's some things that God's going to start perfecting, establishing in him also in a spiritual sense. Then our worship leader's wife, who's up here, Michelle Barnes, having a birthday this week. Let's give her a hand. God bless Michelle. Philippians chapter 3:12 says, not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has laid hold of me. So there's going to be some things I believe that God's helped you to lay hold of, you've not laid hold of yet, that he's promised you. But you're going to start laying hold of them more and more in the months and years ahead, or this year, the months and weeks ahead this year especially. So receive that as well. All right, we're in Matthew chapter 16. I'm talking this morning here again on number two message from a brand new series called Rekindle. I believe there's some things that God wants to rekindle in our nation, in our heart, in our church, in our lives as well. We've gone through a very, very rough patch here in many ways. Our nation has, nations around the world have as well. I still find it very disheartening not to be able to travel overseas to foreign countries because of this virus. And we're praying on a daily basis here this thing blows out of these countries. And we can find ourselves going to airports once again and traveling overseas. But also that God gives us free freedom of movement in our own nation as time goes by. We're in a season right now. I want to talk this morning here about peace over panic. Peace over panic. Because we're in a season right now. Well, there's still a lot of folks that are kind of going through a little bit of a semi-shock panicking stage because in 2 days we have a very, very important election happening in our country. We still have a pandemic raging, it seems like, in many nations around us. We still have fires happening in parts of our country like California, Colorado. We have things happening overseas that are very unsettling perhaps in their economies and their virus and upticks and so forth. All these things in the natural realm could bring a whole lot of panic to us. But God wants us to have a rekindling of his peace right in the middle of panic. Amen. Now, I want to encourage you guys here as your pastor too this week, no matter what takes place or happens on Tuesday, we're not going to wake up Wednesday morning angry and mad and wanting to kill somebody. We're going to take them, we're going to wake up, and we're going to choose whoever's in office in every position of authority. We're going to pray that God would lead them, guide them, direct them by his Spirit every single day. And the church is going to arise, and God's plan for our country is still yes and amen. And we're going to believe that God's going to have his way for our country, and the greatest harvest our nation's ever seen is going to come to pass. No man, no political party can stop that. Amen. Because the Bible says that God made man a little lower than the angels. How many of us know that God's above the angels? Man will always be beneath God, beneath angels, and they're still going to move around us according to God's good pleasure. So I want to say again, don't wake up mad or angry Wednesday morning. And let's be praying this day, praying tomorrow, praying for God's will to be accomplished. So I really believe God does have a will and a desire for certain folks to get raised up and some folks to be brought down. And we're going to believe that God's will is accomplished. Amen. Because God knows more than we do about people. All right. So panicking, something that takes place. I know myself, I panicked a few times in my life, not very many times. I didn't even panic that much on my wedding day. I probably should have, but I didn't. But I did panic a little bit as I was going to India the first time in my life. I was, we were taxiing in to land the airplane in Mumbai, which was Bombay, India, years ago for a leadership conference there and missions work. And as I was, the plane was landing, I go in my back pocket trying to find my passport. And my passport was actually in my jacket pocket up there over in the overhead bin. And so I got up out of my seat and tried to go through the pockets of the overhead bin trying to find my passport in that. It was not there, not in my pockets. It was no place. Here I'm landing now in India with my visa and my passport in a hole I don't even know where it's even at. I started to panic a little bit. And so as I'm standing up there, the Holy Spirit, as he does many, many good times, he comes in just in time and says, look on the floor under your seat. And so I got down on my hands and knees while the thing's taxiing down to land about 100 feet off the ground. And I'm digging down under there, and I put my hand right on my passport. My passport had fallen out of my jacket when I put it up in the overhead bin. It had fallen down on the floor somehow. And praise God, it was still there. I could find it. Okay, so I landed all right. But I know what panic's all about in that realm in a short time. And praise God, that was a short-lived panic in my life. And I'm more careful now about where my passport's at. I truly believe that people right now should take and be truly plugged into a life-giving church in this hour and season. You guys that are online as well, keep on being faithful in your online. Try to focus, try to watch, try to get in a place you can focus on what God is saying. Because churches like this that speak and preach the Word of God give you guys opportunities to come together and praise God and worship God together. And God will recharge your batteries, and God will speak to you a good word in due season that will help you out before you leave this place even today. Amen? We need the Word of God. The Bible says there's a washing of the water of the Word. The Bible says faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. And so I know that faith is released in this place today as a share of the Word of God with you guys that are here also. 7 months has gone by of this pandemic happening in our country. No doubt some habits have been formed in people's lives that might be kind of hard to break in the future. But I still refuse to say this will be the new normal in my life. This will not be the new normal ever in my life. The normal will come back here again when Jesus Christ is breaking forth upon this nation like he never has before. And we're seeing our churches revived and full of the fire of God's Spirit. Amen. That shall be, I believe, the new normal as time goes by. I'm praying for 2021 to be a time that's not more of the same, but a time of divine breakthroughs with God's help and God's grace. So in Matthew 16 now, Jesus actually prepares his disciples for panic. Jesus knows how to take people and put them in the right place at the right time to prepare them and vaccinate them against whatever they're going to be facing in a few days. Because he sees the future. He was God in the flesh. And he saw things prophetically. So he takes them to a place that's called Caesarea Philippi. Caesarea Philippi. Caesarea Philippi is the hometown of the demon whose name is Pan. You might have seen this goat man figure who plays a little flute type thing. He's got goat's feet, goat's legs, and goat's horns, and some man's body from the waist up. Well, Pan was a real god, real devil, worshipped in Caesarea Philippi. And in this place here where Pan was worshipped at, people got themselves up into a frenzy. They sacrificed animals. They sacrificed all kinds of money and goods. They even sacrificed their own children to the god whose name was Pan, probably by lottery. Now, there's three big words we hear today again and again. And those three words are pandemic. And the other word there, of course, is panic. And the other word is pandemonium. We're finding our nation kind of in a pandemonium factor right now today. Now, the one syllable these words have in common is what? The word Pan. That spirit of Pan is all around us today in our own society, in our own world, in many, many big ways, causing panic. And so panic would come upon the people of Caesarea Philippi because they did not know it may be my child they draw the lottery on to get him sacrificed or her sacrificed to this demon god whose name is Pan. And Jesus Christ takes his disciples to that place only a few days before he dies on the cross. Why would he do that? Let's read Matthew 16, verse 11, or verse 13 through 19. Get some answers on this. When Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked the disciples and said, who do men say that I am? The Son of Man is. And they said back to him, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, others say Jeremiah or one of the prophets. He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven revealed this to you. I also say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell," or Hades, "shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed also in heaven." This is a very, very familiar passage here, talking about going to Caesarea Philippi. We've heard that before as well. One thing we don't know about here is the sights and sounds found in Caesarea Philippi in this hour, in this season. If you go to Caesarea Philippi today, you're going to find there's going to be a great big cliff with a great big cave and a big hole in the side of the cliff. In that cave is a bubbling brook, a bubbling pool. The Temple of Pan was built right outside of that cave and that hole in the ground. And they would take and they would do all their sacrifices of animals and people and so forth in that Temple of Pan. Then they said that the actual image and the actual person of Pan would rise up out of the bubbling brook and manifest himself to all the people there to be bowed down and worshipped in that place called Caesarea Philippi. It was so evil, they called it the gates of hell. And that's where Jesus brings the disciples to come and see this place right before he dies upon the cross. Jesus makes them walk for 30 miles from Jerusalem to do this. Now, the reason there again was not to take and cause them to panic and see the panic of Caesarea Philippi. It was to instill in them how calm and steadfast he could be right in a place of panic in the face of the earth. You see that? So what's the point then? Why did he do this? Let's write down three take-home points here. I'll go through these fairly quickly here for time's sake as well. But the first reason that Jesus Christ goes to Caesarea Philippi is to show his disciples and show you and I today in the year 2020, Jesus is our rock. Jesus is our rock. He wanted them to see a strong guy that was totally unflappable, that was not full of fear, that was not anxious, that was not worried. He wanted them to see him, Jesus Christ, the rock, right in the place of pandemonium and the place of panic called Caesarea Philippi. He was not preparing them for the craze of the city. He's preparing them because in a few days, they're going to hear Jewish people that are their brothers and sisters and neighbors saying, crucify him, put him to death. He's a fake, he's a phony, he deserves death. They're going to see the soldiers, you're going to see the Romans, you're going to see all the government officials around them rejecting who Jesus Christ is. They're going to see them, their own selves scattered because of all the fear and panic. They thought that Jesus Christ would rule and reign one way, but he did his own thing a different way. He laid his life down as a lamb that was sacrificial, and he totally caught his disciples by surprise. Panic was all around them. Panic was all over them. He's trying to bring deliverance to them from that panic. Jesus wants us to be in a place where peace will take over our lives no matter what we face in this short life we live. In politics, in pandemics, in economies, in natural occurrences, God doesn't want you to panic. God wants you to have his divine peace in the middle of a very, very volatile world. How many folks believe that? Well, number two is this. Jesus also is our peace. He's our rock, but he's also our peace. Jesus Christ would then take them back to Jerusalem, let them know he was not only the rock, he was also their peace. It was the night before the cross that he gave the words in John chapter 14 and verse 27. And John 14, 27 says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let it be afraid." Jesus Christ is saying, not only am I your rock, but I am also your supernatural peace when it seems like all hell is breaking loose around you. I am your rock and I am your peace. Do not forget, greater is he that is in you than he that is in this world. Amen? Some folks right now, they're panicking. Again, like I said, because of politics, because of 2 days from now, the vote taking place. And I'm saying to you guys again, no man can take and deter what God has in store for this world or this nation or this country or our state or our city. We need to be praying people that are saying, I'm going to see God move regardless of what man can or cannot do in my short life on this earth. We are told in scriptures that God does not give us a spirit of fear, but a power and love and a sound mind. Amen? If fear is in your life right now today, it's not from God. God only gives us power, love, a sound mind, and reason to rejoice. We have no reason to fear. Christ was giving the disciples that day tools they would need for the days ahead. Now, these guys, of course, failed the test. They did panic. They did scatter. One guy kills himself named Judas. These guys failed the test to begin with. You guys may fail the test this week on Thursday or Wednesday or Friday. You may fail the test. But I'm telling you guys, do not give up. Because beyond this day, Jesus Christ comes back to them, preaches to them, encourages them, strengthens them, and shows himself strong and mighty. And these guys turn their known world upside down for Jesus Christ as time goes by. Because they find themselves coming back full circle to knowing who Jesus Christ really is. But also the Holy Spirit comes here and dwells among them now and lives inside of them and works through them in powerful ways to see so many thousands come to Christ. The harvest was reaped mightily in that hour and season. In the midst of our pandemic and the panic around us, what if God is not wanting us to see ourselves as victims? What if God wants us to see ourselves as being victorious? What if God knew this would take place many, many decades ago, and God is actually taking and lining the church up for their finest hour right in the midst of a pandemic and political upheaval in our country? You're going to find throughout the entire Bible that what God does is God tells folks like Elijah the prophet, he says, take those bowls, cut them up in front of all the prophets of Baal, and now pour water on them and soak them with water and fill the trench with water as well. Make it as hard as possible for me to show up and do a miracle in front of all these prophets of Baal. And Elijah does that. Elijah makes fun of their God. He says, where's your God Baal at? Is he on the toilet? Is he busy? Why is he not? They're cutting themselves. They're screaming, yelling, shouting. They can't make Baal appear. So Elijah says, get the water. Pour some water on those bowls and in that trench. Fill that trench up, and God shows up. And the fire of God comes down, and God consumes those bowls, and God licks up all the water in the trench, and God makes all those prophets of Baal get destroyed. And a few days later, he causes even Jezebel herself to lose her life. And I'm telling you right now, this is a time to bind strong men and to attack the powers of darkness and let Jesus Christ take us right to the very gates of hell and say they will not prevail against the church in this hour and in this season. Amen? Because he is that bubbling brook that manifests and comes up and arises among us. He is that one of rivers of living waters. He is that one that's conquered death and hell and the grave. And I'm saying don't let the natural things around you that look so negative perhaps make you panic. Let's receive God's peace in this hour. Last of all, number three is this. The church is built for such a time as this. The church is built for such a time as this. Randy Clark has written many prophetic books, historical books about church history. And he's found in his own research, in the time of plagues and wars and calamities, that is when historically the church has shined the brightest in history. When there's wars, calamities, plagues, and death, the church rises up and shows themselves loving, kind, powerful, miraculous, and healing, and loving and forgiving in all the things happening around them in negative realms. I want you to be convinced today, no matter what happens this week, next year, year after, we are still safe with Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 15, verse 13 says this, now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to have Greg come back to the front now. If you do that, please help me out here, Greg. As I close this service in a moment, I want you to try to find on your Bibles, your electronic devices, try to find Psalms chapter 91. We're going to read that together as a congregation in a moment. Psalm 91. We are those who cause things, the Bible says, to go from the unseen realm to the seen realm. Those things that are not can become things that are if the church will rise up and speak the word of God. We need prayer warriors. We need intercessors. And I'm saying do not shut down in this pandemic, in this political atmosphere around us. It's not time to shut down. It is time to open your mouths up. This is the year of the mouth, the year to breathe, the year to proclaim, the year to declare what God says upon the earth. I want us all to stand up one more time, please. And if you have your Bibles and you have your iPads, whatever you may have there, maybe it's on the screen as well. I'm going to read the New King James Version here, Psalms 91. This is a good thing to prophesy and speak about today. It talks about what God says in this hour, this season of 2020 in the USA. And it says, "He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadows of the Almighty." Let's read that together. "And I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in Him I will trust. Surely He shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor the destruction that lays waste at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your right, at your side, and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked, because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place. No evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. For He shall give His angels charge over you, to keep you in all your ways. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent you shall trample underfoot. Because He has set His love upon me, therefore I will deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation." Let's give God a hand and praise and thank Him. His word is yes and amen. That'd be a great, great verse, great scripture, great chapter to read to your children, your grandchildren, all those dedicated today as well. Read that to them, because that is true. What God said then, hundreds of years ago, is true today in 2020. No weapon formed against us is going to prosper. The church needs to band together, come together. And so I encourage you guys, be postured that this is a time for opportunity. It's not a time to panic. It's a time to look for divine opportunities. People are fearful around us. They need what you've got. You've got the Holy Spirit living inside of you. You have the Prince of Peace in your mind and your heart. Let Him manifest for folks around you that need what you have got in your life. Amen. I'm going to have the prayer partners go ahead and come to the front now, please. All our prayer partners that are here, they're here to pray prayers of agreement. If you have anything in your life that you want someone to pray with you about, it might be for healing for your body. It might be about relationships. It could be about someone not here today that needs prayer. Then please make your way out of your seats before you leave this place today. Come to the front. These guys won't touch you if you don't want them to. If you want them to, they'll touch you. They'll pray for you. And we believe the Bible's true that tells us where two or three agree, touching any one thing on this earth, it will be done in heaven. Amen. We need to pray prayers of agreement that God would take and God would move in our behalf. As you leave today, think about again the Operation Christmas Child back in this foyer over here. Angel Tree is the same place. Is that right, Cheryl? They're both the same place. Next week's Angel Tree. This Wednesday night, we'll be having a praise and worship night together. Just having a time to worship God, praise God, thank the Lord for all of His goodness among us with our worship team. And I think I'm going to say by faith that Greg's got a word for us to teach on praise and worship as well. Thursday night, very important night. We're praying for 1 hour for our country, our nation, new leaders being raised up, people in our congregation, prayer requests you may have yourself. And please, again, always write out your prayer requests on your bulletins, on that paper provided there. Put them in the buckets. There's offering buckets as you leave here, left and right. And those are to receive your tithes, your offerings here also today as you leave this place. You also can give online, or you also can text. And thank you guys for being faithful here. October was another good month for us in finances. We had more than we had to have to pay bills. It's been like that every month in this pandemic. We've had more than we need to pay bills every month. Praise God, because you guys have been faithful. And so we're sowing more and more into missions and other works outside our church. Operation Rescue. There's also a relief fund needed for Louisiana hurricane victims. People like this are needing help. We're doing all we can to go into that also as well, beyond her. I think my battery's going flat. God is saying, quit talking. So I'm going to go ahead and this. I'll let Jack one more time get the microphone, dismiss us in prayer today. If you do that, thank you so much for being here today. We bless those babies in Jesus' name. We bless you grandparents, you parents, all you that came for the service. Thank you for being here to support your family as well. God bless you guys. Have a great week here. And be sure to let us know about your prayer requests. Somehow, some way, God's answering prayers. Amen. God bless you.
Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. One quick word. I have had an opportunity to also sow into Venezuela, an opportunity to get food and supplies down to a people that are very, very distressed. So if anybody wants to partner with me, I'm going to partake of that and start seeing that they get some help in one particular community. So if you're interested in that, please get with me after the service. Also, I do intend on starting up another discipleship class very soon in the church. And I know that there are several people that would want to partake of that. So I'm letting you guys know that it's going to be an in-person discipleship class. And if you think you need that, please get with me. Father, we thank you for the wonderful word, Lord God. Father, we thank you for each one of these children and their families, Lord God, these babies that have been dedicated to you. Father, I pray that the Spirit of the Lord would dwell in those homes, Lord God, encouraging them, be with them, Lord God. Father, in the name of Jesus, that they would be raised in a godly atmosphere. We thank you that they have been set apart to you in the name of Jesus. We thank you for this wonderful word that we received today. And Father, we receive it with joyful hearts. And I pray that your blessing and your protection and your provision would be with all the saints in the name of Jesus. Amen.